Good afternoon, foreign body GI tract, and I welcome all the participants who have come now. I request all of them to unmute their mic so that it's more clear, and also their video. As we go through the case scenarios, you can write your questions and probably we'll take it at the end. I hope you are, my voice is audible to all of you. I think you're on unmute. Okay, I think you're okay. So we'll be doing that. And at the outset, we should, I think, remember all our colleagues and medical and paramedical staff who we have lost during this COVID. And we also pray for the patients and for the whole world who is now reeling under this situation. However, these type of webinars have brought us together, and we continue to do academics because of our interest in the medical field. So my topic today is foreign body GI tract. And this is a very common problem we see in practice. And the foreign bodies rarely occur in adults. When they occur in adults, you get some very interesting findings, like, you know, they use this method of swallowing things and taking even heroin packs. So the first slide, which you are seeing this X-ray, shows packs of heroin in the colon. Just imagine, this is going through a screening and they find like this, and you wonder what this is. These are heroin packs, and these are also heroin packs which these peddlers, drug peddlers, carry it into through their GI tract. So GI tract has been used, and this is a denture. These are common in adults, whereas in children, we see that the common age group for foreign body is 6 months to 3 years. You know, the reason why this is because hand-mouth milestone starts only at the 6th month. And the babies are all very inquisitive, curious. They are attracted to bright, shiny objects. After the age of 3 years, it's more, you know, an accident. It is not because they are inquisitive. The foreign body in the GI tract is rare when the baby is less than 6 months of age, and also in older children. But suppose there is a developmental delay in older children, we have seen these foreign bodies in their GI tract, mainly because the younger sibling, they put it into their mouth. It's a mischievous younger sibling which puts the thing into an older child. So they, even in the less than six months, it is because an elder sibling either puts it into the mouth. So we have seen open safety pins in a 5-month-old baby. And you would have read in the paper, a small fish being dropped into the younger sibling's mouth. The baby was only 4 to 5 months of old age by the 3-year-old child. So the most common foreign body we see in practice is other coins. And why are the coins seen all over the world? It is the coins because universally it is available for the child to reach out. And, you know, it is quite shiny. And the parents sometimes, especially in our country, they give these coins to pacify the child. When a child cries, they will say, okay, I'll give you some money. You can buy some chocolate later. And this is one reason where they always have, you'll find even in government hospitals, in very poor people, you will find a child holding on to something. And when you open that hand, you will find a coin in the child's hand. Other foreign bodies which have been, we see are batteries, toy batteries. Because when these toy batteries are very common nowadays, these batteries can be the cylindrical ones or the disc batteries or the button batteries, which we call. Open safety pins are really alarming, sometimes needles and pendants, marbles and magnets. So when we look into the GI tract, sometimes it will be like a treasure trove. We have seen coins, we've seen erasers, we've seen sharpeners, we've seen pendants, and we've seen rings, we've seen earrings, we've seen lollipop sticks, all sorts of things in the GI tract. So you wonder why do these foreign bodies cause problems? When do they cause problems? And when should they be removed? Should all foreign bodies be removed? So when a foreign body is swallowed, the common sites of foreign body impaction are where you see the yellow stars. So that means in the cricopharynx, in the OG junction, in the duodeno, pyloroduodeno junction in the first part, and then in the ileocecal. So these are the common sites of foreign body impaction. It is probably because the foreign body, the place there is naturally little narrow. So foreign body GI tract, it is good that 80 to 90% of foreign bodies, if they are small, if they are smooth, if they are round, that means small, smooth, round foreign bodies pass spontaneously without complications. So majority of the foreign bodies, you should remember, they will be passed naturally via the natural passage. Only 10 to 20% need endoscopic removal or occasionally a surgical referral. 1% will have complications like perforation, obstruction. But suppose the foreign body is a sharp, a pointed object, like I will show you later, even up to 35% can have go in for perforation. So that type of foreign body, we have to be more careful, and we have to see that these are removed. So reiterating what I have said, spontaneous passage of foreign body is very complication, very important, very common, and complications and need of endoscopic removal depend on the nature and the site of the foreign body. So when will you refer a child for endoscopic intervention? As I told you, 80 to 90% of small, smooth, round foreign bodies are passed naturally. And if coins are swallowed, majority of them are smooth and they can be passed. But the timing of endoscopic intervention is classified as emergent when you have to do it within 2 hours from the presentation, regardless of NPO status. Urgent means within 24 hours from the presentation, following the usual nil peroral guidelines. Elective is when you do it more than 24 hours, you can wait from presentation following the usual NPO guidelines. So timing of endoscopic intervention is classified as emergent, urgent, and elective. Emergent, you should plan it within 2 hours. You are not concerned whether the child has eaten or not. But the other two, within 24 hours and more than 24 hours. So let us look at which are the foreign bodies. So what is the usual presentation of the foreign body? Foreign bodies in the esophagus, more than 30% are asymptomatic, even in the esophagus. But some of them, about 60 to 70%, especially in the esophagus, if they are impacted, you could have dysphagia, you could have drooling of saliva, you could have refusal of feeds, occasionally GI bleed because the child continues to retch. If it presses on the trachea, then you could have a stridor, and the very rare large foreign bodies in a small child, especially the upper airway tract near the entry of the trachea, you could have cyanosis or dyspnea. Cervical swelling, erythema, subcutaneous emphysema indicates that the foreign body has perforated the esophagus or the oropharynx. Once it is in the stomach, majority are asymptomatic. Actually, foreign bodies in the stomach are more a parental concern. Sharp objects, however, can present with complications like perforation or peritonitis. And if you have two magnets, you can have an intestinal necrosis, which I will show you. So why should we remove the foreign body? Why can't we just leave the foreign body in the GI tract? The foreign bodies in the GI tract, especially in the esophagus, could cause impaction in the lumen, obstruction, they could have perforation. And one of the dreaded complications is what we call as the fistulas of the iotoesophageal. Because when the foreign body gets impacted, it presses and causes a necrosis of that area. And since the iota is very close to the esophagus, you could get an iotoesophageal fistula resulting in a torrential bleed and death of the child. Bleeding, Very rarely we have poisoning due to absorption of toxins. This has been reported in a child with a developmental delay who was swallowing one coin every day and had nearly 30 to 40 coins in the stomach, and that a zinc absorption and a copper deficiency has been reported. So I have already told you when to intervene endoscopically, but I would like to give this message again. Foreign bodies in the esophagus, all foreign bodies in the esophagus should be removed either emergent or urgent. They should not be left there after 24 hours. When will you do emergent? That is within 2 hours. That is, you don't even look at the NPO guidelines, our button batteries, sharp foreign bodies and symptomatic foreign bodies. You must remove within 2 hours. Within 24 hours, it could be a coin or a smooth foreign body in the esophagus. Whereas in the stomach, you can wait for some time, especially if it's a round, smooth foreign body. But there are foreign bodies which have to be removed within 24 hours, urgent. These are large blunt objects which have a large diameter. So if they are more than 2 centimeters in diameter, very rarely they pass through the pyloric opening. Or if they are more than 5 centimeters in length, or they are sharp foreign bodies, or they are button batteries and the child is less than 5 years of age, and if it is more than 20 millimeters. Or any foreign body retained for more than 7 days in the stomach. So I think I can talk better without the mask because there's no one here, so it should be no problem. So these are the ways where you can remove the foreign body. This is the way you should. Don't forget this slide. Foreign body in the esophagus, emergent or urgent. Foreign bodies in the stomach, remove it within 24 hours. If they are large foreign bodies, if they are more than 5 centimeters in length, if they are sharp foreign bodies, if they are button batteries, especially when they are large, that is the more than 20 millimeter in size, or any foreign body retained for more than 7 days in the stomach. So what are the important points to ask? Suppose a mother brings a child with a foreign body, what are the questions you would ask in the emergency room or in the outpatient? First, you must ask the mother, what was the type of foreign body the child has swallowed? What are the number of foreign bodies the child has swallowed? What is the time since the child swallowed the foreign body? Did the child eat after ingestion of the body? If so, when? So that we know the time, so that most foreign body removal should be done only under sedation. What are the symptoms? Drooling, choking, pain, bleed, cough, and previous history of any esophageal problem to identify whether there is an underlying congenital esophageal stricture, which I will be showing in one case scenario. So all foreign body ingestions are not noticed by parents of toddlers. And so parents should have a high index of suspicion, especially if there are unexplained some symptoms like drooling, choking, whether there is a foreign body. And what should we do when the child comes to us? You have to examine the abdomen, check for respiratory distress, assess the degree of dysphagia. Suppose the child is not able to swallow its own saliva, that means it is a very severe form of dysphagia, and you can be sure that the foreign body has been impacted in the esophagus. If the child is talking well or speaking well or trying to tell whatever happened well, there's no drooling of saliva, there's no choking, unlikely that the foreign body is in the esophagus. It must have crossed and maybe in the stomach. Always examine the oral cavity, and you have to do the x-ray chest, including the neck and the diaphragm. That means you must take an x-ray which includes the neck, the chest and the upper part of the stomach or the thing, so the below the diaphragm, so that you're very sure where the foreign body is. If possible, you ask them to get a duplicate of foreign body, because it's not always a coin. We have seen very unusual foreign bodies in the stomach. We have seen long batteries. We have seen pendants. We've seen sharpeners. We've seen some parts of the toy. And so if possible, if the mother or parent is able to bring the foreign body, it is good for us so that when we put the scope, we know what foreign body retrieving forceps or device we can use to do it. We can't, after seeing the foreign body, we should not keep on thinking about what is the foreign body retrieving forceps I have? Where do you have the net? Do you have grasping forceps? Do you have a rat tooth forceps? All that we cannot search for after we put the endoscope. And you must assess whether the foreign body is in the esophagus, stomach, or beyond the stomach. So see this first case scenario. This is a very common scenario. It is a two-year-old child who swallowed a foreign body 6 hours ago. And then it is brought to Rainbow Hospital. Mother is not sure whether it was a coin or a battery. Child is restless, has drooling of saliva. Whenever there is drooling of saliva, you can think that most likely the foreign body is somewhere in the upper esophagus. But the child is maintaining oxygen saturation in room air. That means the respiratory tract has not been compromised. And an X-ray is taken and you see a foreign body in the esophagus. Now, this foreign body in the esophagus, the mother has a doubt whether it is coin or button battery. Is it important to know whether it is coin or button battery before we remove, or is it not important? I told you earlier, a button battery needs an emergent removal, whereas if you are very sure it's a coin, you could wait for some time. Though it has to be removed urgently, the urgency, the emergency which you have to do to remove the button battery in the esophagus is very, very important, and therefore you should immediately call the pediatric gastroenterologist or whoever it is, take them, and the child, the button battery has to be removed. So how will we differentiate? This looks both like coin and a button battery. So is it in the esophagus or in the trachea? The child is not restless. The child is maintaining oxygen saturation. So unlikely to be in the trachea, but you have to be more careful. So we always take a lateral view of the neck, and you will find that in the is round, in the AP view, you just find a round shadow. But then in the lateral view, you will be able to find out whether it is in the trachea or the esophagus. So this shows the foreign body in the trachea, whereas the other one shows it in the esophagus. So if you find it is in the trachea, you see the trachea, the air shadow, and you find it over here, you know this is the thing. So these are the foreign bodies. So this foreign body, the other way to diagnose is the double rim, which we talk about. This double rim is very nicely seen in a button battery. Why do you get this double rim? The double rim is formed because you have the two, the cathode and the anode of different dia, and they are placed one above the other in this battery case. So that is why you get a nice rim. And the other one is in the lateral view, you get what is known, because they are in two different diameters, you get what is called the step-off sign. So this double rim and the step-off sign are characteristic of a button battery. So the child whom we saw, X-ray showed a coin in the esophagus, upper GI endoscopy done. Always removal of coin should be done under sedation. Should be, the child should be intubated, because while removing, you should not take the coin and put it back into the respiratory trachea, and the coin was removed endoscopically. So coins can be removed endoscopically. Suppose what happens if the coin was impacted for a little long time, because we usually use a rat tooth forceps. You can see here the rat tooth forceps inserted and you hold the coin. But sometimes if it's there, you may have these sort of an ulcerations even after the coin is removed. But they rarely cause fistulous tract. They are not very deep, and majority of them will become all right just by giving sucralfate. So it's a deep ulcer at the impaction. But suppose they are round foreign bodies and smooth, you wonder why. Why did not the foreign body go down? Why did it get impacted? The size is not large. And like in this case, where a 4-year-old child was not interested in solids, and you know, mothers think that the child does not want. So mother always used to put it in a mixie and give it to the child, because the child used to spit out when she gave solids. But one day while the child was playing, he saw a grape, this green grape, and he swallowed it. And from then they brought the child to me and said, madam, there's acute onset of dysphagia. Child is not able to swallow water. Child is not able to drink anything. The saliva is drooling. We do not know what to do. And I was also surprised. After all, it's a grape. Why didn't the grape slip down into the esophagus was my concern also. So when I put a scope, I saw this going like a ball valve, nice and round. So because it was quite firm, you know, this green grape is quite thick. The skin is quite thick. It had not got digested. It was there. So we pricked it and then we pulled it out. And below that, distal to that, we saw that there was a congenital esophageal stenosis. And that was the reason for this baby having this problem. So we, after removal, you must ensure that you dilate that. So we passed a guide wire and then we dilated. And from then the child was doing very well. So the case three swallowed a screw while playing and restless and not willing to eat. So when you take an X-ray chest, it shows a foreign body in the mid-esophagus. You're okay, you will take it out. And then what happens is you see the foreign body the same way like that child. You see an underlying esophageal stenosis and it has to be dilated. So it's just not removing foreign bodies in the esophagus. Especially some foreign bodies, you must wonder why they are not moving down and ensure that thing. So sharp object in the esophagus, emergent removal. So case scenario four, here is a three-year-old boy who accidentally swallowed a button battery. Mother brought a dummy button battery, which I told you is always preferable, because we have seen mothers bringing all sorts of things saying this is a button battery, but it would be something else. We've seen they've said coin and we found button battery. So this was a 20 millimeter button battery, and you see the X-ray. You can see the double rim. Yes, so you have to remove it emergent. You cannot allow it. And why are we so worried about button battery? So button battery is now becoming very common, more even than the coin. And because it is present in all the modern toys. And disc batteries, what do they contain? They contain lithium. And as I told you earlier, a button battery has an anode, a cathode, and the case. And the disc batteries, which are 2 centimeters or 20 millimeters more, remember they contain lithium and they are 3 volt and they are associated with more complications. Batteries which are fresh or the new batteries are supposed to be more active and cause more injury than the batteries which have been used for a long time. But that should not make us say, okay, it is an old battery, we can leave it like that. Whatever be the battery, it has to be removed. But remember that batteries more than 20 millimeters, batteries which are new cause more injury. And remember the three ends, that is the necrosis usually occurs from the side which comes into contact with the mucosa, and that is the negative, that is the cathode. So negative, it is the narrow ring, and that is the one which causes more necrosis. So these are the various batteries sizes which you see. The smaller ones are the ones which are less alkaline, less charge. It may be just 1.5 volt, but the more alkaline are the larger ones with 3 volts. And what is the type of injury you get? You get a liquefactive necrosis, and the complications have been quite high. You can even get a case fatality if you do not remove these button batteries, especially when they are in the esophagus. So it could cause a perforation, it could cause a tracheoesophageal fistula and a very bad vascular catastrophe, which I was telling you. So this is the liquefaction necrosis which can occur, and it's all because the mucosa gets caught between the anode and the cathode. It comes in contact, and therefore you get a small circuit there itself, and you get a lot of hydroxyl radicals released there. And as I'm telling you, that the new batteries have a threefold greater risk of injury than the spent batteries. And a very good study has been shown in button batteries to tell you when does this injury actually start? That actually even within that 30 minutes, you find the necrosis has started. And the necrosis of the lamina propria has been noticed in 15 minutes and the outer layer within 30 minutes and stricture even within 2 hours. That is the reason that button batteries in the esophagus should be removed within 2 hours. So continued injury despite removal of the removal of the battery may even continue even up to 19 days. So it's always better to remove it as early as possible. So the complications of button battery, it could be a perforation as mentioned earlier, it could be a fistula, it could be mediastinitis, it could be a vocal cord palsy, it could be a massive bleed, it could be a stricture. So prompt removal of battery is very important to prevent the complications. So this is a button battery in the esophagus. Button needs emergent removal and see the impaction, the type of injury which occurs. The post removal also, even after you remove, already the time has occurred and you get this sort of a necrotic ulcer over there. So we have to be careful even after removal and they need follow up. So this is the thing where the button battery removed 4 hours after ingestion had developed and you found after, even after it has been removed, just because of the delay in removal, a fistula tract had occurred. So is there any way to decrease the damage before reaching the endoscopist? Suppose the child is in a district, there have been some studies, can we do something till we reach? If it's just 2 hours, it may be very difficult. So even in USA, the toxin managing group, they felt that something can be given. And this was a very nice study where they've said honey when given to a child who has a button battery in the esophagus seems to decrease the hydroxyl radicals being formed. And a very good study where they've showed that if you give saline or sucralfate, honey seems to be better. And how much honey? You can give 10 ml ingested every 10 minutes till for about, you can give about 6 to 7 doses and you can give it because the pH itself changes. But one should not go in search of the honey, trying to find out whether you want Dabur honey or you want Khadi Gramayogi honey and delay the bringing the child to the hospital. You can give honey, but not delay the time. So you can give 10 ml by mouth up to 6 doses. Do not worry if it's little excess or the timing. And how does honey work? It is administered to coat the battery and prevent the contact between the button battery and the adjacent tissue. But it's not a substitute for immediate removal of a battery lodged in the esophagus. So honey slows the development of battery injury, but won't stop it from occurring. So they should not delay going to an ER to obtain or to, because they had to get honey. And this has been approved by the National Capital Poison Center battery ingestion, even in USA. There's been one more study, so which they have said, and they've said that even during removal, the endoscopist and the surgeons give about 0.25% acetic acid wash at that place so that they prevent this injury there. And they have seen that the deepening of the ulcer after removal was less in that group. This is an open safety pin also in the esophagus. Whenever you see an open safety pin, you're very concerned. It needs emergent removal. And this was a very young child. And it's all because the mother said while the baby was drinking milk, it probably took it from the chain. So all foreign bodies in the esophagus, a reminder for you, need to be removed as emergent within 2 hours post swallowing. Even after removal, the injury cause needs to be assessed and follow-up may be required. Smooth round foreign body in the esophagus, always consider stenosis, stricture, post-anastomotic TEF, and endoscopic esophagitis, that is eosinophilic esophagitis. What about the stomach? Stomach, as I told you earlier, majority can be passed naturally, but there are some foreign bodies in the stomach which are removed urgently. And I've already told you that foreign bodies which are larger than 2.5 centimeters or longer than 5 centimeters in length, or they are sharp foreign bodies, or they have been there for more than 7 to 10 days. So this was a child who swallowed a coin 14 days before, and parents are more worried. They are visited three doctors, and you find that the coin was in the stomach, but the next x-ray shows the coin seems to be in the esophagus initially, then it's come into the stomach, and now here you wonder whether this coin is in the small bowel or is it in the stomach. But remember, whenever a coin is in the same place, it mainly it is in the stomach. This is along the greater curvatures of the stomach, and you can see this. It is actually the stomach, and we did the endoscopy. It was there and it was removed endoscopically. See, the color of the coin has completely changed, and you can use nice baskets are available, known as the Roth basket, which completely wraps around the coin and then you can remove it. So this is a case scenario 6 where a child, mother noticed the child was playing with a toy with an open and has opened the battery box, and she just saw the child putting something into the mouth. And then when she comes to the child, she finds that the car's battery box is open and three button batteries which had been there is going. She is really concerned, but the child is calm and happy. So she's worried, three button batteries. And when we took the x-ray, look at this, like an ohm, three button batteries in the stomach. And so this needs removal. But suppose the child has taken food, you have just some time, but within 24 hours, you have to remove it. So you follow the NPO guidelines, because there is a risk of complications and bad bleeding, even if it is in the stomach, though it is much less than in the esophagus. So these coins were removed. And when you look at the coin, you always see, you will find these markings there. And this is the part which is usually the plus part for the anode, and the other side will be the cathode. So here you have to remove, because you see that the negative is touching the mucosa. But you don't have to look at all that. This is just for us to know that button batteries, little more about the pathophysiology. Then this was a child with recurrent vomiting and abdominal distension. So whenever you have abdominal distension and vomiting, you don't think too much about a foreign body. But when this X-ray, the radiologist made a comment saying that this looks like a bezoar. There's a lot of matter inside this. There are some air pockets. And then they said, let us look at it. And this was what was known as sofa story. I think you would have all seen this. I just enjoy this Fevicol advertisement where this sofa goes from the father, and it's given to the daughter-in-law, and then it keeps going. It's a lovely song also. But how I remember the sofa was, when I put the scope into this child, there were pieces like this. And I was surprised. I had not seen sort of things like this. It was very hard. It was like a resin. And then when I asked the father, what is this? Did you not see a two-year-old child putting things in the mouth? And he said, Doctor, can this be from our sofa, which is in the living room? Because our sofa, there is a corner where all pieces have gone. They are missing. So we were wondering what had happened to those pieces. So, you know, things are happening in their house. There's a sofa which is being destroyed or nicely being peeled off. The rexin has been taken off. The sponge is being eaten by someone. They think it's a rat or they think it's something. They could not imagine that it was their child who was doing it, and this child was brought. So we had to remove all that. And then you also know, this was another very interesting story where a mother said that her elder son has developmental delay. He was sitting there, and the younger one is only 3 years old, but she heard him say, Vayatara, Vayatara, Vayatara. Just open your mouth, open your mouth. So she said, why did he say three times? I was not sure, but both of them were playing with coins. So doctor, I'm worried whether the child has swallowed coins. So we thought, yes, maybe we did see a coin, but when I put the scope, I thought there were three coins all stuck to each other. And I was a little excited, and you know, I took this Roth basket and I took all the three, or actually there were four coins stuck so much, and I didn't even realize it. I pulled all the four coins out, but then it could not come out through the cricopharynx, and then we had to do all out of tricks, put it back. It did not open, and then finally it opened, and we had to flush this coins which were stuck to each other, remove them one by one. So what went in one by one had to be removed only one by one. So they were removed. So this is a child who was much older, 7 years, but the younger baby had done it. This was another problem. It's a more litigation problem where a dentist and the child and the parent came to me and they said, imagine this was during dental procedure, this part got swallowed by the child. And the father was very angry. The dentist was really scared and this got swallowed. I was really also very wondering what could do. We took the X-ray. We found the sharp foreign body in the stomach. The child had already eaten and was given bananas. So I told the father, don't worry, tomorrow it will come out. But he could not trust me. And he thought that because the dentist was my friend, I was trying to support. I was also scared till the next day what happened. But no, there is an axiom known as Jackson's axiom, where the advancing needle, that if it is a pointed part coming in the front, they rarely poke, they just keep coming down. So advancing points, that is the point which goes forward, is always should be the one that it doesn't poke. So it nicely went down and then the whole foreign body came down. So this was good in the sense that the foreign body passed naturally, so we didn't have much of litigation. But these foreign bodies, it's preferable that you admit the child. If possible, this foreign body from the stomach itself should have been removed, or if it is elsewhere, admit the child, keep the surgeon's opinion, and then wishful waiting. But this was, we were lucky that the foreign body was passed out. So foreign bodies in the stomach, as a retrieve, I just like to say that they have to be removed within 24 hours. And as I told you, foreign body more than 5 centimeters, in length more than 2 centimeters, sharp foreign body, button battery in the stomach, and any foreign body retained for more than 7 days, very rare, they do not come out naturally. What about beyond the stomach? Beyond the stomach, we have to remove it endoscopically, like this hairpin which got caught at the sweep of the duodenal cap, and then we had this screw which was more than 5 centimeters, which is also lodged in the duodenal cap, and then this up, you can see a part of this hairpin which was there, and then we had to remove it. Now there are very good foreign body retrieving forceps. Then the case 10 is a child was brought with distension, fever, abdominal pain, 2 years 9 months, vomiting on the first day, and the parents just said casually that the child was playing with magnets kept in a art piece. So the child was quite sick, and when we took the X-ray, though we say the two is better than one when we do this tug of war and all that, but two is not always better than one when there is magnet. So one magnet, nothing happens. Sometimes they'll just pass. But then when you have two magnets, what happens is these magnets will always try to come together to each other. So when they move at different paces, they get a part of the intestinal mucosa in between them, and you will get necrosis. So they will cause multiple perforation wherever they are trying to meet each other when the mucosa comes in between. And so this has to be removed only surgically. So multiple magnets are very bad, and best is to remove them surgically. So in the small intestine, what will happen if the button batteries have crossed? You can wait. If the abdomen is soft, they may get passed out, a regular X-ray, or then you may have to call the surgeon. So we use some protective devices to remove sharp foreign bodies from the stomach, and this is there. And so foreign bodies beyond the stomach. So if it is small bowel, you have to, if complications are present, you have to remove. Beyond the reach of the endoscope, if there's obstruction or magnets, we have to remove. So, dear doctors, and thank you for this patient hearing, but I would like to give you some take-home messages. X-ray chest and abdomen, including neck, should be taken. Do not get panicky. The parents may get a little worried, but do not. Radiolucent foreign bodies may not be visualized. Ultrasound is not a good imaging for localizing foreign body. You can do a CT if necessary, if the foreign body is radiolucent, to find out the site. ENT surgeon can help if the foreign body is in the cricopharynx. So endoscopy is sometimes both diagnostic and therapeutic, like I showed you. And child should be kept NPO since procedure is done under anesthesia. So till the definitive treatment is given, please keep them in a low risk. and thank you for your patient listening. I think we have some chats, questions. You can send your questions if you have, or on your chat box.
Hello.
Hello.
Malti, this is VVV.
Thank you. Thank you. You're here. Okay.
When the button battery has passed beyond the stomach,
yeah,
and it is in the intestine,
sometimes
we have had even 3 or 4 days of waiting before it is expelled out.
Yeah.
Is there any cause for concern, or we can wait when it is beyond the...
Sometimes transit time will be different. So earlier we were saying that if you can see a nice rim of the button battery in the small intestine, it is actually a button battery which has not leaked and will definitely come out. For them, you can give a stool. We don't usually give any laxatives so that unnecessary problems we don't create. But if they take a normal diet, and if the child is one who passes motion every day, then they usually pass it out. We've not done any surgery, but you have to keep watching the abdomen.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Madam, Dr. Murthy here.
Yes, doctor.
Madam, excellent presentation, madam. Thank you for enlightening all the foreign body problems. And I have one.
Tell me, doctor.
Actually, be on the scope of the gastroenterologist, it will be the surgeons next. Always we will be. Yes. The parents will be always worried when the foreign bodies crossed the stomach. So they will be always worried.
So, actually, I had one child with a foreign body who had swallowed the toothbrush, doctor.
Yeah.
So the head was with the mother and the whole thing was with the inside the stomach.
Okay, madam.
I got scared also because that one foreign body toothbrush I removed. Because there was the old ones, Binaka forans. So there was a hole.
Okay.
This did not have, and so it was difficult. So I had passed the surgeon only to remove.
But as far as
you carry on, Murthy, I'll follow later. You carry on.
Sir, madam, I have one query. How to differentiate when the foreign body is in stomach or colon? Most of the times, the delayed foreign bodies, when they take, even when we take the X-ray, lateral X-rays, and most of the time, it will be difficult to differentiate when, even if it is a coin, whether it is a
colon. I have never seen a foreign body staying in the colon at the same place. Colon, they rarely stay at the same place, even whether you always think it's in the TC. But why should it stay in a TC? Only when it is lying in the greater cavity, you see it in the same place for some time. Next year, if you see it in the same place, it's unlikely to be the thing. But you know, when this doubt comes, rather than exposing the child to X-rays through the endoscopy, the parents are also happy.
Yeah.
Because actually, that's why I said sometimes you do the endoscopy to find both for diagnosis, because they tell us coin and there are some round foreign bodies with a big button battery in the stomach.
Okay.
Foreign bodies in the stomach, we can coins, we can even for 7 days, we've left even for 10 days. But if it's a button battery, we cannot leave.
Exactly, madam. Yeah.
I hope you remember. We had a 1.5 or 1.75 year old child with a mutton piece sticking onto the small intestine in child rest 4 or 5 years back. It was refusing to come out, then had to be opened and removed.
Yeah, so all these when we see, you know, but we should always keep in mind why, because in the small bowel, by the time it passes, it should start getting digested. Either there is some problem of motility or something, and then it forms a big bolus. things happen and the parents start giving some food, which makes it bigger and bigger. And these are the things which I think. So usually that type of foreign body, it should have got caught even in the esophagus if it is getting caught in the small intestine, no? But so why we think we should look at other things. Sometimes we see these foreign bodies inside the stomach, little big piece of mutton. So usually we used to use papain because this papaya, green papaya has a substance which can help in dissolving these small pieces and then we remove it.
Thank you very much, especially for the honey tip for a battery button till they go to the ER.
I think that was a very nice study also, doctor. And I was also happy that something is there, something new has come. And especially while it come, and I thought it was someone has really thought about it. They've compared it with an animal study and now it's recommended. So with water, saline, sucralfate and honey, they've done that. And they have even done after that, while removal even for us, when it's a button battery, just don't remove the button battery. Give a wash with 0.25% acetic acid. I think Dr. Murthy also will appreciate this. This was really exciting for me also that we have something new. So Dr. Geeta, good afternoon, Geeta. Role of antihistamines of PPIs in button battery during the waiting time. I think that doesn't work, Geeta, because all this, you're just going to waste some time and try not to do anything. Just bring them over. But I said, as I told you, this is the only one which has helped because they've compared sucralfate with honey and found honey better.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, ma'am. There were too many questions, so I thought I'll send a text message.
Okay.
What about wooden foreign body?
That's good.
What about wooden?
I think there are no more questions. We are just closing and thank you all for this opportunity.